Hi, my name is Madeline de la Cruz, and thank you for joining me for another podcast of Rhyme and Prejudice. I wonder if any of you listeners have ever read the poem Goblin Market by Christina Rossetti. The lines, "We must not look at goblin men, we must not buy their fruits," have been etched in my memory ever since I read them as a little kid in the library. I still remember reading the poem and being dazzled by the illustrations of goblin men selling fruits. I was also very confused when one of the characters started licking fruit juice off her sister's body. By now, most of you are wondering if I had accidentally strayed into the wrong section in the library, but I can assure you that this poem was indeed in the children's section. However, it should have been in the adult section, especially since Rossetti intended the poem for a mature audience. To begin with, Rossetti was a poetess living in England during the Victorian age. Goblin Market is Rossetti's most famous poem. It even made her popular in her own time. The poem tells the story of two sisters, Laura and Lizzie, living together in the woods and listening to the goblin men's tempting call to come buy your orchard fruits, come buy, day in and day out. Their life is spent together in peace until Laura is tempted to buy the fruit and falls ill. At first glance, the audience views the life these two women lead as erotic and intensely romantic. Their relationship is easily interpreted as such when Lizzie faces the goblin men to save Laura from dying, comes back covered in goblin fruit juice, which is the antidote, and asks Laura to hug me, kiss me, and suck my juices. Despite these sexual innuendos, the poem may not be as risque as it seems. This is because much of Rossetti's inspiration for Goblin Market came from her experiences at a penitentiary for fallen women. By knowing the poem's background, the audience's perspective of Laura and Lizzie changes from romantic lovers to women with a close bond living together. Let's take a look at the section where Laura comes back after braving the goblin men. Pay close attention to the poem's alliteration, repetition, and rhyme scheme as I read the passage aloud. She cried, "Laura, up the garden, did you miss me? Come and kiss me. Never mind my bruises. Hug me, kiss me, suck my juices, squeeze from goblin fruits for you, goblin pulp and goblin dew. Eat me, drink me, love me. Laura, make much of me. For your sake I have braved the glen and had to do with goblin merchantmen." Laura started from her chair, flung her arms up in the air, clutched her hair. "Lizzie, Lizzie, have you tasted for my sake the fruit forbidden? Must your light like mine be hidden? Your young life like mine be wasted? Undone in my undoing and ruined in my ruined? Thirsty, cankered, goblin-ridden?" She clung about her sister, kissed and kissed and kissed her. Tears once again refreshed her shrunken eyes, dropping like rain after long, sultry drought. Shaking with anguish, fear, and pain, she kissed and kissed her with a hungry mouth. First, let's analyze the poem without knowing the background behind it. At first glance, it does seem that Laura and Lizzie do have a profound love for one another. Rossetti uses vivid alliterations such as "hug me, kiss me, suck my juices," and "eat me, drink me, love me" to express Lizzie's love for Laura. The action verbs in these lines turns Lizzie into a passionate lover, asking Laura to whisk her off into erotic ecstasy. It seems like Laura obliges her by kissing her repeatedly, as seen in the lines, "kissed and kissed and kissed her, and she kissed and kissed her with a hungry mouth." That's quite a lot of kisses Laura gives to her so-called sister. However, Laura's comments on Lizzie's return is not phrased romantically. "Lizzie, Lizzie, have you tasted for my sake the fruit forbidden? Must your light like mine be hidden? Your young life like mine be wasted? Undone in my undoing and ruined in my ruined? Thirsty, cankered, goblin-ridden?" Lizzie doesn't proclaim romantic love for Laura, since there is no romantic diction in it like "I love you" or "I adore you." Instead of Laura thanking Lizzie or professing love for her, she is adamantly worried for Lizzie, since she thinks she'll become sick like her. Also notice that there are a lot of literary pairs in Lizzie's response. The first four lines have an enclosed rhyme scheme, "tasted, forbidden, hidden, wasted," which gives us two pairs of rhymes. The third and fourth lines have paired alliteration, must your light like mine, and your young life like mine. And there is a pairing of repetitive alliteration in the lines, undone in my undoing and ruined in my ruin, which are also couplet. All of these literary pairings point to a strong sisterly bond between Laura and Lizzie. Yet why do the two women show intense love for one another? This is where Christina Rossetti's background clarifies things. Christina Georgina Rossetti was born on December 5, 1830, in London, England. Her parents were Gabriele Pascal Giuseppe Rossetti, a Neapolitan nationalist who was an expert on Dante, and Frances Mary Lavinia Ni Polidori, sister to John William Polidori, who wrote The Vampire. In 1824, her parents fled Italy to England as political refugees, where they had her sister and brothers, Maria Francesca in 1827, Dante Gabriel in 1828, and William Michael Rossetti in 1829. She was the youngest in her family. She grew up in a close-knit and loving environment, surrounded by her family and visiting scholars, adventurers, and patriots from Italy. All of these foreign dignitaries and researchers acted as a playing field where she could enrich and test the knowledge her mother taught her. Rossetti and her sister were educated by her mother, a former governess, as training to become nannies when they became older. Her education consisted of reading the Bible, the writings of St. Augustine, and of course, the works of Dante Alighieri, as presented by their father. Even though Rossetti and her siblings read these books assigned to them, they preferred imaginative delights of the Arabian Nights or Thomas Keith Lee's fairy mythology. Later favorites included Sir Walter Scott, Anne Radcliffe, and Matthew Gregory Monk Lewis. These works fueled her wild imagination and led her to become quite the handful when she was a kid. As a young child and teen, she was rambunctious and wild. Rossetti's father considered her and her brother, Dante Gabriel, to be the two storms of the family, in comparison to the two calms, Maria and William. Dante Gabriel even drew a sketch of her tearing a room apart in a fit of rage. Despite her rowdy nature, she declined in her health at the age of 15. It was also around this time that she became critical of herself and pious. This was such a change in character that her brother, William Rossetti, remarked on it in his memoir. Her temperament and character, naturally warm and free, became a fountain sealed. Impulse and elan were checked, both in act and writing. The drastic change in her behavior might have been a result of, as her biographer Jan Marsh puts it, an attempt at parental incest by her father who became blind in 1843. He speculates this because Rossetti was the only one at home taking care of her ailing father, and she often had nightmares of a disgusting clammy fin reaching out to her in the darkness. In 1845, after tending her blind father for 2 years, Christina Rossetti declined in health too. She became solitary due to her poor health because she was often alone at home with her father. The rest of her family worked to support their finances, since her father could no longer teach Dante to his students due to his blindness. During this reclusive time, Rossetti mainly stayed at home and looked after her father, prayed, or wrote poetry. When she was not at home, she was volunteering at different religious charities. Her experiences at these charities became the inspirations to many of her poems. In 1859, she volunteered at St. Mary Magdalene's Penitentiary in Highgate, a charitable institution for the reclamation of fallen women. Fallen women in the Victorian age referred to prostitutes and women who had sex outside of marriage. The penitentiary gave shelter and work to these fallen women, seeking to rehabilitate them and steer them on to a more socially acceptable path. Christina Rossetti volunteered frequently at the charity from 1859 to 1870. She felt a strong affinity for the fallen women and even stayed overnight many times at the facility. Her experiences inspired her to write poems which dealt with subjects like fallen women, their redemption, and sisterhood dynamics. It is these notions that get incorporated into Goblin Market and explain why Laura and Lizzie act intimate yet sisterly with each other. Laura and Lizzie are not lovers, They are two fallen women that share a sisterly bond of each other. This explains why Laura's response to Lizzie risking her life for her is filled with sisterly pairings of alliteration, repetition, and rhyme. It also explains why Laura worries that Lizzie's life is undone in my undoing and ruined in my ruin, since Lizzie may have lost her purity to the goblins like Laura did when she ate their fruit and dropped a tear more rare than a pearl. The pearl in that line refers to Laura's purity, and that is why she fell when she paid the goblin men. That's why Lizzie says, "Laura, make much of me," since she came back with her purity intact. It's also the reason why Laura kissed her with a hungry mouth, in order to regain her virginity. Without knowing the background behind this poem, Laura and Lizzie would have still seemed like a lesbian couple instead of women who were close to each other. It is important to know the history behind Goblin Market and the context it was written in so that Christina Rossetti's original message can get across. That's not to say that Goblin Market can't be interpreted as an erotic poem. It has plenty of imagery to come across as such. However, I do believe that it is essential to know Rossetti's true intentions so that her perspective and her story can be told as she intended it to be told, beyond the boundaries of her time. Well, that's all the time we have for today. Join me again another time for another podcast of Rhyme and Prejudice. And as always, may your rhymes be harmonious and your prejudices checked.